and it gives you a really creepy feeling if the characters are not perfect. I think even in one of the Star Wars, the latest Star Wars, you know, they had, you know, Princess Leia, and that was still a little creepy to me when I saw it. I was like, oh, still it's not the real deal, you know. So we're still not there yet, right? But it was much easier for us, especially with the tech that we had at that time, to go in this route, right? We could actually squash, stretch, and push proportions. And this was much more appealing to us. We could have much more range and diversity of character proportions, which was awesome. So then we ended up, sorry. There we go. Sorry. So yeah, going, like, just doing head studies, right? You see that they're very simplified, really chunky, blocky. That's so that we can actually make them more iconic, geometricized, as I called it back in the day, and low poly, which is important, so that it can run on a toaster. And it was a small crew of people. Like, Team Fortress didn't start off with this massive dev team. It did actually just start off with about 6 developers, and 5 of them were artists, right? So it was Zabi and I doing characters, and Zabi would pitch one idea, I would pitch another, and we'd take certain tendencies and match them up and see if they worked. And then we're just like constantly creating proxy models to get them into the game and see if they actually hold up in a variety of different lighting conditions, distances, and viewpoints, yada, yada. So that's, you know, the final outcome. And just as a funny story, so halfway through the development of Team Fortress, we brought in a bunch of like core Team Fortress Classic players in a focus group. We gave them little memos. We printed this image up on the screen, pretty large, no titles, and they walked in and they knew what these characters were. 100% of them knew exactly what this game was, and 100% of them hated the design. So you can imagine, these guys literally, it was like all these guys left the room upset, really upset, very angry, and actually angry kind of at me. I was like, what do we do? Like, should we do what they say? Should we go and do realistic military? We decided, fuck it. No, we know what we want to do. We're going to just go open and try it. When we shipped, we ended up getting all these baskets of, you know, wine and cheese and stuff from them. And, you know, please forgive us for our behavior. And it was, of course, got it. But it just showed you, sometimes you, like, when you're challenging inventions, it's kind of scary to be innovative in a sense. And we knew at that time that we were swimming upstream. Like, we weren't swimming with all the other people. We weren't looking at other game art. We were actually looking at artwork outside of the gaming paradigm. Why not, right? And I feel like right now, a lot of artists we're looking so much at the incestuous art that's already out in games, pre-existing. And I understand that. I mean, I'm a big fan of ArtStation and the artists that are there. But I want to go and find it in other places. Go to museums, go outside and into real life, and maybe go to the, I don't know, go to the library and do some research, you know, rather than, you know, copying and plagiarizing, you know, what's already out there. We're trying to mix all that stuff together. And that just kind of convolutes the entire thing. So you guys have an obligation as artists and as creatives, right? Creativity is not a vocation, right? Like, this is our way of life, and you guys have just as much right to design, right? To spearhead new and innovative art styles that are going to further the cause of video gaming, right? And really give it its just due. I mean, development cycles for video games range from, you know, that's a small little indie team, could be 6 months. It's other companies, it could be 6 or 7 years. So spend that time wisely and find the right thing. Glean, do the research first. Find the reference and innovation and inspiration. That's the way to do it. So just as a painterly process, right? This is what was setting us up for success in a sense, was that we were actually going into gouache painting, right? So this is actually, analog painting 101. But we actually start digitally, so we can really quickly get the silhouette shapes into place. So after we do a quick, this is like a half an hour. You print it out on paper, get some charcoal, put it on another piece of paper, toned paper in this case, and then you rough it in. And then you'd add the opaques. And then after this point, after that's all approved, and by the way, I had to fight so hard to get the pyro into the game because I'm not going to say he or she, it had a mask. And Valve was kind of upset because they wanted us to show the face. They wanted to show like the idling technologies. And it was like, let's have one character that is mysterious, that nobody knows who, what, or if, or what it is, right? So anyways, so after this stage, we go to the model sheet. And in current technologies, everybody kind of bypasses this. It's kind of one of the most important things. It's they take about three days to a week to do per character, at least for me. And by the way, at Valve, they called me Slowby, or Slow-Mo. I was slow, right? I was not a fast draw, but I could shoot straight. But, like a dad joke. So once you get to the stage, right, and once it's like, we're like, oh, this is pretty cool, we get it to the stage, right? So I'm just gonna go back and forth so you can see, you know, how aligned we're trying to be. Now, this isn't just like, this is about a month worth of work with paint overs and really trying to get the character refined so that it's adopting that shape language. But then when you start actually scaling it, that's when the magic actually starts happening, so that you're actually getting very, very clear and homogeneous characters that all look like they come from one place. So that, you know, when you bring them all to the final, they all kind of look like they come from one artist, right? That's kind of a fun thing to do, fun thing to be a part of. And then like as far as like pipeline, you don't want a texture to take 3 weeks or a month, right? So texturing a TF2 character, even though it like to get to that stage it took us a couple of years, once we got down to our process, it only take 1-2 days, maybe 3 days max to do a character's texture. Because yeah, we were just using an occlusion on top of it, so it's just like mostly color shapes and gradients. Super simple. So it was funny to see the characters in their open face versions, but it's a lot of fun. Like I actually got to do all the textures for the characters, which you know allowed it to really teach me as well about the clarity of each of the characters and how they would all coexist within the world. So the Reed hierarchy was going to be a very simple one. We'd experimented early on with, you know, brown colors, warm versus cool, but at the end we obviously settled on the red versus blue because of colorblind, and that it was analogous with the classic Team Fortress. So red team is analogous colors, blue team analogous, mostly cools, red team mostly warms. Warm grays, cool grays. And then in black and white, characters still hold up. They're basically in the same value range, but they have different chroma. And so that even if you look at the characters in a black and white photo, you can still see all the characters existing within the world. And then you add color to it. So analyzing this one screenshot, you can see that the heavy is popping from the analogous red desaturated background. And then the red characters are much more saturated than the world, right? That's all intentional. That's so that the clarity can really be seen, because characters need to be seen in a variety of different lighting conditions, distances, and viewpoints. See, I'm very like repetitive because it's like inculcation. That's how I roll. So then in the world design, the goal was to create an immersive and believable world, team distinction through materials such as wood and concrete and corrugated metals, and obviously like hue saturation values. And we wanted an impressionistic, non-photorealistic painterly look. So then again, it's to the research. And you're only as good as your research. So we looked at Jack Delano, who was a photographer from the 1930s. And he was actually experimenting with color photos. And he was he was paid by the government to go throughout the United States, parts of South America, and even into the Caribbean, He even went to the Virgin Islands, where I'm from, and he did a bunch of really great color photos of the islands, you know, from 50, 60 years ago, and they're really beautiful. So we're taking away from Jack Delano, like kind of that era of time, pre-1970s, basically. A lot of the stuff is like either torn down or even more dilapidated, so we're actually seeing it in its functional state. But we're also looking at shape design, right? And when you squint your eyes at this slide, for example, you're seeing geometry. Now, we're not going to put all the detail into the trains, right? That's just too visually active. So we had to end up really simplifying everything down to its core essence so that they actually match the characters and they didn't dissuade. A lot of game companies out there tend to do that, right? Like they tend to, you know, the world designers want the worlds to shine, and the character artists want the characters to shine, and then you put them all together and they're all competing, right? So, you know, working with Jeff Ballinger, the environment artist on this, like he totally got what we were up to. And it just made our jobs much easier. So just even analyzing this image, right? Again, rectangles, triangles, linear elements, small areas of visual activity like pallets and trash cans and posters and, you know, just the train cars and all that stuff. So we're looking at all those things and seeing how they all add up in composition. Then we're juxtaposing this dilapidated kind of world, industrial world, with the spy tech, which is much more cleaner. And we're not going to go for something that's modern, right? So we're going to have to go back to the original James Bond. I mean, why not, right? Like, so, and it's even more fun when you can, you know, when you can stylize it in such a way that it's not all modern. It just goes away from like what everybody else is doing. We're also looking at toy sets, right? Little miniature train sets, so we can have like bigger, blockier, chunkier scales, so that they actually fit more with our character design. So here are just a couple of examples of models and whatnot. Very simple. Dollhouses, this is very important. This actually allows us to see how the scale and proportion of our all the elements of the environment actually interact, kind of like panning yourself back. And then again, in our concepts, looking at Jack Delano, we're doing rectangles, squares, triangles, linear elements, just really quick in grayscale. And then we do paint overs on top of that. Color, we worry about that's later. We don't even know what the texture style is going to be at this point. We're getting up to that stage. This is Jeff Ballinger's work. I love the fact that he put these cows that are basically just cut out cows, and some of them are tipped over. And you know, when you're playing the game, they're kind of like on the outskirts of the world. So it has this Cold War mentality to it. Then we do little simple color keys just to give it like, okay, we know that these are going to be our basic colors. Just really simple. Nothing. We're not spending a lot of time. We're spending like a day on those things. Contrasting team properties, right? So, it's super important to know that you're on the right team, right? So the red team has warm colors, natural materials, angular geometry, while the blue has cooled colors, industrial materials, and orthogonal forms. It was really fun in this stage. Like, we're really figuring out how to have like clear team distinctions. I mean, it was wonderful. So then it got to the rough shelling phase. And it's so cool to go in this. I'm sure some of you guys have done this before, but it's really a time to you're constrained into a map design, right? So you have to build kind of above and around. So instead of having like the walls that the original Team Fortress Classic had, you broke those things down so you could open up the world. So that's what this phase was really all about. It's like just getting our composition kind of set into the place where we wanted to be. And then we started adding the characters. None of them are textured yet. The world, we're actually putting this huge like glaze of scanned watercolor, because at this point we're kind of experimenting with actual analog watercolor paintings. Are we gonna actually do like, are we gonna take the model sheet or the texture sheet and actually paint analog? It's gonna take too much time, so we had to refine that process. So what we ended up doing was we used like scan data from real materials, but we posterize it, and we've used a foundation of gray rendering to kind of push that through. But obviously we were looking at artists outside again of the industry. Hayao Miyazaki, by the way, I got to meet the guy, and he signed a book. I was very excited about that. That doesn't happen a lot, right? I got to do that. The textures of Hayao Miyazaki were fantastic in the sense that they held up frame to frame and at any angle in the game. And Jeff Ballinger took full liberty to make that happen. So he started off in grayscale again, very, very simplified, very simplified. And then he would start adding all these different layer techniques to it. And that gave it a little bit more sense of the tactile quality. He would do that for concrete. Again, here we go, and train tracks. Very simple, while still using like an occlusion bake, just a hint at the trains. And we were hand painting all this stuff. All the weapons had a hand painted feel, but still held up to the tactile quality of what those weapons were, which were mostly metal, obviously. Skyboxes, very, very simple, right? Nothing too active, because we don't want the viewer or the player to look up at the sky while they're playing, right? So everything is meant so that you're looking, you know, at the ground plane. So once we get the proof of concept, right, this was after about a year of development when we first started. All of the models are textured, everything is inside of the game, and we run around and we see how it all works together. It was really an exciting time. This is where we invited Gabe and some of the senior programmers at the company to see what we were working on. Gabe was extremely enthusiastic, by the way, because we were able to, by this time, really talk about the hows and whys of, you know, everything working. So he kind of gave us a nod. Some of the other programmers were not so enthusiastic because they were used to seeing, you know, realistic stuff. And they were like, I don't understand why the wood it's not wood. And we're like, no, it's hand painted, you know? Anyways, we ended up going for it. So I just want to go do a before and after of where we ended up, right? So this is the old, Two Fort map from 1996. And notice we blow the walls down and we give it this theme, holds up great. At the same time, you take a normal, you know, just a humdrum, you know, generic box, and you actually open up the world so that you know exactly where you are within the map. It's very important. So I'm just gonna run through these relatively quick, sort of somewhat running out of time, and that's just the way it goes. So instead of like, you know, Fred Flintstone land, we've made it into a gold mine. So just a lot of fun. And if you guys look at the screen, there's a sign that says Cornwell. That part, that's paying our respects to Dean Cornwell, one of the Golden Age illustrators. So we'd leave little Easter eggs out there. So maybe people would understand who that artist was, or maybe they wouldn't, but had to look good anyways. Expanding maps and making maps, this is Well. And Well had this impediment area in the middle, and we couldn't understand what it was going to be. So we actually ended up convincing the game designers to open it up into kind of like a train depot where you'd have to run through, and it kind of made the game even more fun, more, obviously, like more challenging. So just running through, getting rid of 255 green, like that was something that I didn't want a lot of purple in 255 green or 255 red, that was it. So we tamped all those colors back and let the characters really shine. And at the end, I mean, this is what I love about this game, is that if you posterize it, if you use a threshold in Photoshop, the characters, you can still see them, right? They almost have that Mignola feel to it. So that was something that was really exciting for me to see when we were experimenting with like the clarity within the game. Characters still held up. You could still see the silhouettes of the buildings and all that, so it was really fun. And then on to League. So this was the SRU dev, and I had been hired at Riot back in 2013, and they offered me to work on